We are looking into about water management, then we will look into agriculture water management. Not here. Irrigation is efficiency, as I mentioned, about 30 to 40% is only on average about 35% of the water is used by the crops. But rest 25% is lost in field application losses. This may be due to conveyance loss, like water is evaporated before reaching the plants altogether. Conveyance loss, improper, you know, pipes and sluices, dams or check dams, there will be losses there. Losses at outlets and other losses. If you look at this percentages altogether, only 35% is water is being effectively used. In India, as I mentioned, about 650 billion meter cube of water, out of which only 33% is being effectively used. That's about 200 to 250 billion cubic meters of water. If you improve the agriculture water management, India will, you know, able to, you know, sustain the end of, you know, water scarcity and stress all together. So how can we do that? We can do that by improving access to sustainable water in dry rainfed areas, investment in a lot of funding in water agriculture and infrastructure access, reducing the conveyance and distribution losses in irrigation, increasing crop water efficiency, and water efficient farm practices. So how do we improve this 35% to, let's say, 50 or 60%? We can do that. We can do that by, you know, doing micro irrigation. Either it can be a drip or sprinkler irrigation, land leveling, ridge and furrow irrigation, cover crops and mulching, direct seed and drive. These are some of the farm practices that can be used. These practices will increase the efficiency from 55 or 60%, improving the return flow management and farm level water management training. This is the training is given to the farmers and other, you know, people involved in the agriculture sector, so that they are, you know, kept up to date with the latest technologies and the latest farm practices. These are some of the, you know, farm practices that I have mentioned earlier. Like if you look at this middle row left one, this is called land leveling. This reduces it saves water about 25%. Drip irrigation, its efficiency is about 90%. Contour and borer bed furrows, these are called raised bed funding, high impact in using the water efficiently. Some of the other mechanisms are enhancing storages, improving conveyance and operation, enhanced access to water, minimize blue and green water losses in favor of transpiration. So what is the green water is called water, the water from the rainfall altogether. Blue water is called water stored in groundwater or surface. Demand management, efficient water use, or supplemental irrigation. Conjunctive use of water and poor quality and by using poor quality and wastewater altogether. So conjunctive versus instead of rather depending upon groundwater altogether, we switch between sources between groundwater, surface water, and rainfall, so that there will be minimum stress put to an individual groundwater source. Exploiting interaction of genotype and agronomic management, crop diversification, and multiple water uses and integrated farming systems. And also finally, this all comes towards increasing water productivity. So these are the major, you know, crops grown in India. And if you look at it, and right now, especially rice, we produce about 150 grams per 1,000 liter of water applied, if you look here. And if there is we use a genetically modified rice variety, we'll be able to increase the water productivity by about, and if you are further in adding water management solutions to that, you'll be increasing the productivity about 45% and soil management of 15%. So these are the major crops that are grown in India. And this second column shows what is the current water productivity in India. And the column 3, 4, and 5 goes on to show that what is the potential, you know, how much water productivity that can be increased in India. So about 50 to 60% improvement in crop water productivity is possible through land and water management interventions. So one of some other ways of improving agriculture water management is increasing per unit of water consumed. So it can be done either by improving water management to reduce stress at critical crop stages, improving non-water inputs that increase production per unit of water, changing of new or different crop varieties with higher yield per unit of water consumed, and then move to the next part, which is reducing non-beneficial depletion. So which is here increasing the proportion of water applied that is used beneficially by crops, restricting evaporation from bare soil, from like it can be done by, you know, mulching, like applying dead crops over the wasteland so there is no evapotranspiration from the bare soil, reducing water flows to sinks, which is water flows to deep percolation and other surface runoff, and another minimizing salination. Salination that can be reduced by applying fertilizers, etc., of recoverable return flow. And the next step is also you have to tap uncommitted flows, which is adding water storage facilities, improving management of existing and reusing uncommitted return flows. And the next step is reallocate and co-manage water among users. Reallocate water from lower to higher value users within or between sectors. It can be either agriculture sector, domestic or industrial sector, while addressing possible effects on downstream users. Co-manage water through multiple users. Finally, we come into, these are the on-field farm practices. But there are like other policy changes that needs to be made so that there will be efficient water management practices. See, at the end of the day, no matter how much water management or how much changes we bring in the field, the farmer or an individual farmer wouldn't care for these things unless he sees that there is a rise in income, because his main livelihood is depending on the income, not because of whether India is facing water scarcity or water stress. So for that, India needs to do, you know, policies changes all together. Like, we need to do more holistic or interdisciplinary approach. Like, for example, leveraging MNREGA for water efficient farm practices. Most of you know about India, this unemployment program, which is Mahatma Gandhi program, which it guarantees about 100 days of, you know, labor for the people in rural. So right now, these people are being, you know, used in public, like digging trenches, ponds, tanks, in the common places. What I'm proposing is that we can, you know, focus on, can divert this labor force into private lands, whereas the government doesn't have to pay, so that expenditure, you know, encountered by the exchequer will be reduced, so that the individual farmer can pay these wages to the farmers, so that this MNREGA laborers can be trained for the latest technologies in farm practices. So it's a win-win situation for the farmers and the government altogether. And also we have to do a major change in food policy. So right now we have moved from water intensive crops to market demands. If you look at this, in India, we are, you know, producing lot of wheat and rice in India, especially. So to give a sense of idea, in the year 2018, India required about only 40 million tons of rice and wheat. That's including the buffer zone. Let's say if there is a famine and drought, that can be covered with 40 million tons of wheat and rice. Care to venture a guess? India produced about like 70 million tons of wheat and rice in the past year, like in 2018. That's about, we are producing like twice the amount of required rice and wheat in India, especially those are water intensive crops. So if you look at this, we have to go deep into our farm practices. Like, you know, a lot of people in India know about Green Revolution, Swaminathan and Seema Swaminathan's Green Revolution, which happened about 1960 to 1963. That time India's facing a severe shortage of cereals, which are rice and wheat. That time our main focus was to produce as much cereal as possible, but right now our supply and demand is bit counterintuitive. On the one hand, we produce a lot of food, but on the other hand, the food prices doesn't go up that much. Like, we produce a lot of wheat and rice, but the prices of those wheat and rice doesn't go up. If you look at the composition of the food we eat to the composition of food we produce, one can see a mismatch. So like right now, people are, you know, consuming more eggs, more, you know, dal, more more pulses, more millets, etc., because people are more getting to know more awareness about the nutrient security of. So there is no point in overproducing wheat and rice, because people are, you know, moving away from rice and wheat. Especially the meat consumption in the past 10 years has been increased twice fold. So we have to look into how to change the policy so that the people are producing less wheat and rice. And especially the, as I mentioned, the food policy of the Green Revolution is very pro-cereal. So the idea was then idea at the time was to produce enough wheat and rice. The policy remains where it is, but with the rising income, the demand for cereal hasn't increased that much. But a supply of cereal has, on the other hand, has gone up very much. So the policy framework is pro cereal, and but the demand in the past 50 to 60 years is moving away from pro cereals. So how can we overcome this moving? How can we move away from producing more wheat and rice to more, you know, more poultry, more meat, more, you know, dals? How can we move away from this, move from rice and wheat to this kind of products? So that one we have to look into ECA, which is Essential Commodities Act, so that the farmers will have an APMC, which is Agriculture Produce Market Committee, and contract farming. So right now in India, a farmer cannot, you know, sell his product directly to a market. So right now, say if I'm a farmer, if I'm producing 100 tons of wheat, I cannot sell my product directly to a consumer. The current situation recently, in the past month, the Indian government has changed that policy though, but previously it was that I have to take my 100 tons of rice or wheat to a mandi in my district only. I don't have option to, you know, sell my rice and wheat in the next district. I have to take it to the mandi. The price for the rice and wheat is fixed at the mandi. It's not fixed by the farmers. So right now we have to look into those kind of policies changes, etc., so that the farmers can move away from water intensive crops to more nutrient efficient crops. And also we have to look into giving, you know, roll back our incentives and subsidies giving to the farmers. So we have to limit the free water and power of agriculture. So this can be done by fixing caps based on crops. Let's say if I am growing, the government will fix a cap on how much electricity I can use based on the research methodology that this amount of land requires only about 10,000 liters of water for the entire growth period. There will be a cap fixed for the farmer. So if the farmer crosses the 10,000 liters of water, he will be charged after that. So right now the Indian government and the World Bank is working on a program similar to this, so that the farmers become more and more aware of the water efficient farm practices, while at the end they will be able to increase their income and maximize their profits. And if you look at this graph, when it compared to India's water footprint to global water footprint, 20% we are consuming more water in producing wheat and rice when compared to the global average. But when it compared to sugarcane, which is also a major crop grown in India, we are consuming slightly less than the global average. This is mainly due to earlier farm practices that's adopted by all the farmers in India. So the next step of improving water and agriculture management is improving conveyance and distribution system. These are the systems we have looked earlier. And one more thing, right now India is majorly investing space technology and ICT, which is information and communication technologies, and precision irrigation system. So, and diagnostic tools based on decision support systems of linkage of canal operation and on-farm water management. So as I mentioned earlier, right now Indian government is working on some of them, along with our organization, which I'm currently working. They are using artificial intelligence, big data, and machine learning. So one of the technology right now that Indian government is working on is, if there is a rainfall on day one, it will automatically send a message to the farmer via cell phone or a call, the farmer, on which day they have to irrigate that land. Right now, the farmer doesn't have the idea, like if there is a rainfall, they will irrigate the land on the next week. But it doesn't necessarily have to be that. Next week, it can be after 2 weeks. So we can use big data, machine learning, and artificial intelligence to efficiently, use the water and increase the water crop production and increase the incomes altogether. So the latest thing, some of the examples, using satellite imagery combined with other data to produce practical agriculture information of farmers. There are a forecasting mechanism which says there will be rainfall in the next 10 days, so you don't have to irrigate your land, so you can save water and manpower, and complex water and crop growth models that run for field using the combination of data and satellite imagery, producing specific and customized advisory for each farmers. Smart ICT project implemented in 3 countries in Africa, which is Ethiopia, Sudan, and Egypt. As I mentioned earlier, each farmer will get a message via SMS or a phone call that says what needs to be done if there is a certain amount of rainfall or temperature, when they have to harvest, or where they can sell their farm produce to maximize their products. So there is a huge, huge potential for growth there. So let's look into the domestic industrial water sector. In the domestic water management sector, we have to, as I mentioned, about 80 to 40%, we have to reduce the conveyance losses there. We have to promote water efficient household pipes and fitting, subsidies for water efficient households. So this is also one of the program that my organization IMI is working with World Bank, which is, so a particular household will be given a certain amount of water. This is practically, implemented in most of the parts in India, but India is planning, the government is planning to, implement this in India altogether. A household will be given 1,000 liters of water per day. If the household crosses the 1,000 liters of 1,000 liters, they will be charged accordingly. So those are the comes up. Then one of the things, how to, implement those technologies in each households by implementing meters and such. And also in industrial water management, water efficient manufacturing process, like there will be a strict monitoring protocols to make sure that latest, machineries are being used. So there is which consumes very less amount of water, and which incentivizes water efficient factories and production practices, and stringent policies on wastewater treatment. So this can be, if you look at this data, about 62,000 million liters of water, wastewater is being generated in India. But out of the 62,000 million liters, only about 23,000 million liters of water can be treated in India. About 39,000 million liters of water is left untreated in India altogether. So that's a huge, mismatch in treating water. This can be, the demand supply graphic can be, mismatch can be reduced by, implementing STPs, sewage treatment plants, or ETPs, effluent treatment plants, or combination of both. ETPs are mainly used for pharma and chemical industries, which are efficient, effective in removal of non-toxic chemicals to purify water. And STPs are mainly a contaminant of household, wastages, used for, household wastage or treatment of wastages. And DVATS, this is one of the new technologies that we have been developing, which is, the abbreviation is DVATS, which is defined for decentralized wastewater treatment system. The first two, treatment system, STP, ETPs, and activated sludge plants, they require a certain amount of electricity and a certain amount of manpower, certain amount of fresh water required to treat those. But in DVAT system, the entire process, it's treated without any use of electricity or fresh water to treat it. It's a natural process which is treated, altogether. One more thing that in people we generally, tend to forget, that is we always discuss the elephant in the room, that is, we always discuss about the wastewater generated in the urban areas. But what about the rural areas? If you look at the rural areas, there is no, if you look at villages in majority of India, rural villages, there is no proper mechanisms to treat the wastewater from households. It is, directly discharged into ponds, rivers, or open lands. So it's basically what we are doing is we are, people in rural India is contaminating their own lands, which in other ways can be used for agriculture. About 45% of wastewater generated in rural India is discharged into open lands, which can be otherwise used for agriculture. So especially in states of Punjab and Haryana, about 90 to 95% of wastewater generated in rural areas is discharged directly into either in rivers or ponds or tanks. So we have to also not only focus on urban areas, but we have to also focus on treating wastewater in rural areas also. So these are the challenges that you face. Now we have to look at what are the future directions of water and agriculture management in India. So for that, we should start with develop adequate water infrastructure. shift the focus from new construction to improved maintenance and management of water infrastructure, develop informed ways to support evidence-based planning and management, incentivize water use efficiency in all sectors. All sectors mean domestic, industrial, and agriculture sector. Shifting subsidies to water efficient practices, diversification of water efficient nutrient rich crops, bring more water efficient crops under MSPs. MSPs is minimum support price, and focus on location and climate specific water management system, improve consumptive water use, and institutional reforms that facilitate water user and other stakeholder engagement, like promoting public-private partnerships. So these are the main things, that these are the past, present, and future of water management in India. Now, finally, I will, you know, briefly discuss about what are the career opportunities in agriculture and water management. So this is a very niche field as such. This field is a subset of a subset, which is, this field is a subset of civil engineering. You know, a lot of people have studied hydrology, irrigation water management in one of their semesters. Even I have studied this kind of courses in one of the semesters. This can be further expanded by doing their masters in agriculture management, environmental management, or hydrology and water resource management. So these, when it compared to other bachelor's degree or other, you know, general civil engineering fields, which are generally focused on infrastructure and other stuff, if you look at career opportunities in agriculture and water management, especially in lot of, you know, high institutions in India, like if you want to work in major organizations like World Bank, Niti Aayog, which is a think tank for Indian government, or United Nations, and all these major organizations, they look into these kind of niche fields. So they look, they look for a particular core expertise. So people can, you know, get into this field, and this, apart from the job satisfaction, you will be able to bring a major change. That, you know, if you bring a major policy change, if you are able to design a policy that impacts the entire Indian region, not only will be getting more salary, but also you will be getting a more job satisfaction. It will be impacting the, it will have major impact in government level altogether. So you can go into academia, which is becoming a professor in leading organizations like IITs, IIMs. Even IIM Ahmedabad has a open positions, a department separate for agriculture water management altogether. And consultants, these are consultants in providing consultancies to World Bank, Indian governments, research think tanks. You can act as a researcher for all this, all the development, all the governments or other world development banks. And development banks like World Bank, NABARD, National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development, and other KfW Bank, which is a German development bank, SDG, which is Swiss Development Bank. And these banks are looking into more kind of sustainable practices. So if you look into these water and agriculture management field, there are like huge growth potential, career potential in this field. And also right now in India, there are a lot of, you know, agricultural startups which are focusing on, you know, and developing major, you know, water efficient farm practices, so that they are, you know, they can incentivize farmers to increase their income.